Welcome to the 2018 Black History Program at the Kashmere Gardens Church of Christ. The theme of this year's program is anchored in the roots of our rich history. We pray that we learn from our history and we reflect on our past and our present and look towards the future as we grow stronger. Thank you and enjoy this presentation.
We're going to have a duet by Kashmere's own Haley Jones and Jazari Lewis. Give it up for them.
Open door. She said, in the streets is too many temptations. Mother His love for serving Christ led him to work in graciously and giving back to the youth group. Anthony has remained faithful to the Lord, even as he's traveled, even as he lived in various cities in and around the country, due to his work responsibilities. Needless to say, Brother Anthony will be sharing with us a more rich roots about his growing up here in the Kashmere Gardens Church of Christ. And how it affects his professional responsibilities. Without further ado, great pride, we give a special homecoming welcome to Kashmere's own homegrown son, Brother Anthony Pierre.
Good afternoon, everyone. Yeah. And I'm Anthony Pierre. Many of the older heads that are here right now know me. I was raised here in this church,
yes,
and I have a great love for this church,
yes,
and this church holds a special place in my heart.
Yes,
this presentation here is going to be about 20 minutes long, and today we're going to talk about African-American history. Specifically, African-American first. Significant people of our race who have contributed to African-American history and also American history. We're going to talk about significant people in the areas of government, the areas of law, military, science and medicine, literature, film and television, as well as sports. Now, I'm sure the majority of people that are here right now would recognize the majority of people here on our screen. Everyone probably pretty much knows who Floyd Money Mayweather is. Serena Venus Williams. Beyonce. King James, number 23. Denzel Washington. Cory Booker. Madea. We don't recognize those people. I think it's safe to say that these people live a pretty good life. They probably have a nice home, probably make good money, probably drive some pretty nice cars. They live well. They live well because of the sacrifice of people that came before them that struggled. It's safe to say everyone here today, you and myself included, we may not live as well as those people that you just saw, but we live a whole lot better than our previous ancestors lived. Our previous ancestors were brought here to America as slaves, sold on slave ships. They were forced to come to America to work for a slave master. They came to work for someone. Someone told them what to do, how to do it, and when to do it. They didn't have a choice but to do it. You know what? I stand corrected. They did have a choice. They could say no. I'm not going to do what you told me to do. But in saying no, there was a grave consequence. And I literally mean a grave consequence for refusing to do what you were told. See the picture on the right? That's the consequence that I'm referring to. That's the consequence I'm referring to. Thankfully, because of our ancestors, today, in 2018, the picture on the right is a very rare sight in today's society. And I'm thankful for that.
Amen.
And the reason for that is because of those that came before us and the struggles and the sacrifice and the pain and the torture and death that they endured for all of us. Our first thing we're going to talk about is government. There's a mayor here by the name of Carl Stokes. Today in 2018, we have a number of mayors throughout the United States. But this was the first, Mayor Carl Stokes. Charles Stokes, he was the first black elected mayor in the United States, in the city of Cleveland. He paved the way for the many mayors that we have today, one of which right here in Houston, Sylvester Turner, but this was the first. The next person is Governor Pinchback. Governor Pinchback, he was the first black governor of a U.S. state, the state of Louisiana, back in 1872. Now, this presentation is going to go pretty fast. These people have done a number of significant things. However, I'm simply highlighting just one or two points on each because we don't have time to really go in depth about each individual. I would like to challenge you after today that you take it upon yourself and go to a library, go to a bookstore, or just go to Google and do some research about these individuals as well as others. Next person is going to be Congressman Joseph Rainey. Congressman Rainey, he was the first black person to serve in the U.S. House of Representatives. Congressman Rainey, as you see here, was born into slavery, all right? I think it's safe to say that being born into slavery is pretty low. Throughout his life, he worked hard and achieved the position of congressman. A lot of times today, we'll make excuses or give reasons as to why we can't do certain things, why we can't accomplish certain things. Now, certain things, it may be difficult for us to accomplish, but if we put our mind to it, put forth the effort and determination, we can succeed at whatever we want to succeed at. If Congressman Rainey, who came from a slave and became a congressman in the 1800s, can do it, we can do it in this day and time period. The next person is going to be Congresswoman Shirley Chisholm. Shirley Chisholm was the first black woman elected to the United States Congress. Shirley Chisholm. Next person we're going to talk about is Senator Hiram Ruggles. Hiram Ruggles was the first United States senator. Also a politician, a minister, and a college administrator. You're going to see one thing that's consistent about these individuals. These individuals, they prepared themselves for the positions that they had. No one just up and just gave them those positions. They had to do some preparation. They had to go to college. They had to pave their pathway in life. Nothing came easy to them, okay? The next person, a native, Barbara Jordan. Barbara Jordan, Houstonian. First African-American elected to the Texas Senate and the first Southern African-American woman elected to the U.S. House of Representatives, Barbara Jordan. Kara Mosley Braun. She was the first female African-American senator, Senator Carol Brown. Now, Colin Powell, Secretary of State Colin Powell. He was the 65th United States Secretary of State. He was the first black male to hold that position in the George Bush administration. Next, Colin Powell helped pave the way for this female, Secretary of State Condoleezza Rice. She became the first female Secretary of State for the United States, Condoleezza Rice. Now, this is about as modern day as it gets. This was major American history, African American and American history that happened, 9 years ago. President Barack Obama. Goes without saying, I think we all know, the first African-American president of the United States of America. And of course, you can't mention Barack without mentioning Michelle. Where's Michelle? Come on, Michelle. First lady who carried herself, in my opinion, with much class and dignity in the White House. The next section we're going to talk about briefly is going to be law. We're going to mention two people. The first person we're going to mention in the area of law is going to be Federal Judge William Hastie. In my career field, I deal with a lot of federal judges. There are not very many black federal judges in this year, in 2018. But Federal Judge William Hastie became a federal judge back in 1950. He was the first African-American federal judge. Next, we're going to have the first female federal judge. Her name was Constance Baker Motley, the first female African-American judge. Next, the military. We see this picture here. This is one of many pictures of the Buffalo Soldiers. The first person we're going to talk about in the military that made history was combat pilot Eugene Jacques Bullard. He was the first African-American military pilot. Next is going to be Military General Benjamin O. Davis. He was the first African-American general in the United States Air Force. He was a four-star general as well as the commander of the Tuskegee Airmen in World War II. This gentleman here is Sergeant William Corner. He was an African-American soldier during the American Civil War. He was the first African-American to receive the Congressional Medal of Honor, which is a very distinguished award in the U.S. military. Once again, Colin Powell made history twice as the Secretary of State, as well as the Joint Chiefs of Staffs. He was the Chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staffs, the highest military position in the Department of Defense. So when it comes to the military, Colin Powell was the man. He was the man over the military. First African-American to hold that position. Next area we're going to briefly talk about is going to be the area of science and medicine. This gentleman here, Thomas Jennings, he was an entrepreneur. He had his own business. He operated and owned a tailoring and dry cleaning business. He was the first African-American to receive a patent for a particular product. And his product was a dry scrub process, but he was the first black person to ever get a patent for a product that was made. Next, Dr. James McCoon Smith. He was the first African-American to ever hold a medical degree. He was also the first African-American to run a pharmacy in the United States. Next, female doctor. Dr. Rebecca Lee Cromer. She was the first African-American woman to become a physician in the United States. Her specialty was she provided medical care to the freed slaves after the Civil War. Most of her patients were poor women and children after the Civil War. Dr. Charles Richard Drew, he was the inventor of the blood bank. In addition to inventing the blood bank, he protested against the practice of racial segregation and the donation of blood. At one point in society, whenever someone gave blood, white people gave white people blood. Black people gave blood only for black people. There was no cross amongst the races. He fought against that and said, blood is blood. As long as it's A positive, B positive, O negative, or whatever it is, it can go into anyone. It doesn't matter the race. The only thing that's important is the blood. Dr. Charles Richard Drew. Next, we have Dr. Daniel Hill Williams. Dr. Williams, he was the first African-American to successfully perform a heart surgery. Heart surgery, the very first. Next, astronaut, Macy Jemison. She was the first African-American woman to travel into space. Look at her history. She was an engineer, a physician, and also an astronaut. That's saying something. You know, if we prepare ourselves for life, how can society tell us no? With her history, with her biography, how could she be told no? With that type of history, being a physician, an astronaut, as well as an engineer, she could do whatever she wanted to do. Who's going to tell her no? She has the credentials to do whatever. Next. Robert Henry Lawrence Jr. He successfully completed the U.S. Air Force Pilot School. After that, he was selected as an astronaut in the Air Force Manned Orbital Program. Thus, he became the first black astronaut in U.S. history. Robert Henry Lawrence Jr. Literature. The first person we're going to talk about is going to be Harriet Wilson. Harriet Wilson. She became the first female African-American novelist. She was the first African-American to publish a novel in North America. Next, Phyllis Wheatley. This name should ring a bell to us. Phyllis Wheatley. Basically, Phyllis Wheatley. She was a poet, and she was the first person to publish an African-American. She was the first published African-American female poet. The next person we're going to talk about is going to be Gwendolyn Brooks. She's the first African-American to receive the Pulitzer Prize for poetry. Her works dealt with the personal struggles of ordinary people in her community. During that time period, most of our poets and literary writers, they tended to write about what they knew. So a lot of what they wrote about was their experiences or experiences of their community. So that was commonplace. Gwendolyn Brooks. Charles Gordon. He was the first African-American to win the annual Pulitzer Prize for Drama. He devoted much of his life to the pursuit of multiracial American theater and racial unity. Let me add this about these individuals. These individuals, they achieved success, but they didn't only achieve success for their own personal reasons. They then went back, many of these people became community organizers, went back into the community and tried to help those in the community and help other African Americans. So when we do well in life, don't forget where we came from. Go and try and help others succeed as well. Don't have a crab in a barrel mentality. Next, Toni Morrison, first African American to receive the Nobel Prize in Literature in 1993. Next area we're going to talk about is going to be film and television. Sidney Poitier. First African-American actor to win an Academy Award for Best Actor. He was also the first African-American actor to win a Golden Globe for Best Actor. Oprah Winfrey. Oprah Winfrey, she was an American media model, talk show host, actress, producer, and philanthropist. The talk show Oprah Winfrey Show was the highest rated show of its kind in American history. Oprah Winfrey. Next, sports. Jackie Robinson, number 42. He was the first African American to play in Major League Baseball. Prior to this, I had done some study on Jackie Robinson, and it was kind of amazing and what he went through, traveling from city to city, trying to play baseball. The way that he was harassed and mistreated, it was really sad. Just to play baseball. Jack Johnson, this was prior to Mike Tyson. He was an American boxer. During the Jim Crow era, he became the first African-American world heavyweight boxing champion. He paved the way for Mayweather, Mike Tyson, Holyfield, and all those guys. We know Serena and Venus, right? All right, this is the old school. Serena and Venus Williams. Althea Gibson, the first black athlete to cross the color line in international tennis. In 1956, she became the first African-American to win a Grand Slam title, Althea Gibson. Her counterpart on the male side, Arthur Ashe. He was the first black player to be selected to the United States Davis Cup team, the only black male to ever win single titles, at Wimbledon, the U.S. Open, and the Australian Open. Arthur Ashe. Modern day. Tiger Woods. Say what you want to say about Tiger now. But when Tiger was in his prime, Tiger was dominating his field. Tiger Woods, one of the most successful golfers of all time. During his prime, he was one of the highest paid athletes for a number of years. We're coming to a close here. Just a couple of more. The next person we're going to talk about is going to be Booker T. Washington. Yes. Booker T. This is the person, after today, do some research on this guy. This is good learning about Booker T. But just a snippet about him, Booker T. Washington, he became the first African American to be placed on a U.S. postage stamp. He was an educator and author and an ally to the president of the U.S. and also a major African American civil rights leader, Booker T. Washington. Next, we have Potter, Bessie Coleman. She was an American civil aviator. She was the first African American woman to hold a pilot's license. Now, see this guy right here? He's wide-eyed in a library of some sort. Let's open up our eyes and anchor ourselves in the roots of our rich history.
Yeah.
I challenge everyone here today that after today, go to a library, go on the internet, and just do some study about these people and many, many, many others who have contributed to African American history and have made our lives a whole lot easier today. Thank you for your time.
With that amazing presentation. Now we'll have one more selection by Brother LaMarcus Thorne. Give him a round of applause.
Pass me a lot, oh gentle Savior. Thank you.
Amen, amen, amen. Now, at this time, it's time to find out why I celebrate February. It's time to find out the reason why you and I both celebrate February. Give a warm round of applause for Miss Aaliyah Jones.
See? Sister Alicia Lawson. Give her a round of applause.
Alicia Lawson.
Good afternoon, brothers and sisters.
Good afternoon.
I say good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Okay, so this is the moment we've all been waiting for. We have something a little bit special for you this afternoon. This is not like your ordinary Black History program from the past. Oh, Sister Pam, she made this year's a little bit more special for you. Is that all right?
Yeah, all right.
All right. Today, we are presenting to you the 2018 Black History Who Am I Game Show! Okay, so at this time, I would like for all of my Black History presenters to come forward and take your seats.
All right.
So while they're taking their seats, allow me to go ahead and tell you a little bit more about the game show. The Black History presenters will come forward. They will tell you a little bit more about themselves. And they will ask you one question. Who am I? So when they ask you that question, that's when I need your cooperation. Is that all right?
It's all right.
You have to guess who they are. If you know it, yell it out, scream it out. Okay, any questions? Okay, the game show must begin. Our first Black History presenter, Matthew LaCour, come on. Any guessers? Matthew, go ahead and tell the audience who you are.
I am John Matzenbeger.
All right, thank you, Matthew.
African-American
woman in the United States.
My adventures include sold a hot comb used straight out natural kinks and curls in black hair.
Mr. Joshua Sweat. Come on down, Joshua.
I was a record holder, NFL running back, who excelled in the Hall of Fame in 1972. Not only did I excel in football, but I also excelled in track, field, and basketball. Retiring early from football, I became an actor, starring in movies like The Dirty Dozen and The Hundred Rifles. Also, I became an outspoken activist. Who am I?
Joshua! Joshua!
I am Jim Brown.
All right!
By soldiers and vehicle operators. It was known, it protected people worldwide. The gas mask, the traffic light that I invented, stopped automobile crashes all over the world.
Mama.
Who am I?
You're
correct.
All right. Thank you, Brother Young. Okay. We have a dynamic duo. I would like for Cameron Tatlin and Joelle Williams to come on down.
Here is one of my favorite quotes. Adjust. Get creative. Try a different move or a different shot just to make it work. Renowned by my basketball shooting accuracy, I was the first NBA player to be named Most Valuable Player, receiving an unanimous vote for this honor. Who am I?
Cameron, reveal yourself. Who are you?
I am Wardell Stephen Curry.
All right! Joelle Williams.
I was born in Maryland on September 29th, 1988. Early on, my basketball skills led me to play for the University of Texas in Austin. I am a three-time NBA All-Star and a three-time NBA scoring champion. I was only the eighth player in NBA history to accomplish this feat. Who am I?
All right, Joelle, reveal yourself. Who are you?
I'm Kevin Durant.
All right. Thank you, Cameron and Joelle. Next we have Miss Shante Hamlet.
Because I was a dressmaker, I Before my invention, people used to just take a board and lay it across two chairs to press out clothing. I want to cheaply produce something more convenient and highly effective. Who am I?
Sarah Boom!
All right, Alana, who are you?
Sarah Boom.
Next, we have Mr. Jared Johnson. Come on down, Mr. Jared.
I was born in 1954. I won 3 Grammy Awards, 2 Oscars, and 1 Tony Award. Some people say I'm the greatest actor alive. You may know me for some of my earlier works.
Oh my Lord, 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 Lord. Oh my Lord, 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 Lord.
I ain't much on praying. I ain't really have no family. But I love the 54. Y'all's my family. Whatever happens tomorrow, we's men. We gonna die on our feet. Who am I?
Jerry, who are you?
Denzel Washington.
All right. We got some Denzel fans in the house. Okay. Our next one, Mr. Zion Jones.
Was an African-American preacher of the Church of Christ, whose successful career bridged a racial divide in an important American religious movement prior to the Civil Rights Movement. Here are a couple words from one of my sermons you may know. Can you get an amen?
Amen.
Zion, can anyone, do I have any guesses first? Zion, who are you?
Without my contributions, you may have not known about such people like Booker T. Washington, Harriet Tubman, and Sojourner Truth. Who am I?
Margaret Kay.
No. No. Jaylon, who are you?
I am Carter G. Woodson.
All right. I'll be switching up on y'all this time. Okay, our next one is Isaiah Savannah. Come on down, Isaiah!
I was a famous lawyer for the NAACP. What made me so famous was the landmark case, Brown versus the Board of Education, which outlawed segregation in schools, thus allowing black and white students to go to school together. My efforts were fought by many white people, especially those living in the Deep South. Nevertheless, the case went out and became a law. Who am I?
Okay, Isaiah, who are you?
Thurgood Marshall.
All right. Thank you, Isaiah. All right, next we have Sister Eloise Lolo. Come on down.
here in Houston at the Church of Christ. I traveled to Southwestern Christian College, traveled all over the world, singing. Also, I went to Abilene Christian College. Now it's better known as Abilene Christian University. Also, the favorite songs that I sung at the Southwestern Christian College by traveling, it is,
there is a name I love to hear, I love to see its words. It sounds like music in my ear, the sweetest name on earth. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Because he first loved me.
Who are you, Sister Marlo?
Amen, amen. At this time, while they're taking their seats, we're going to have another solo song by Sister Brooklyn Braun. Give her a warm welcome, y'all. Brooklyn Braun.
She wanted the church to serve as encouragement and motivation and as inspiration to our youth. So for the next few minutes, a lot of what I'm going to say is really targeted towards the youth. And besides, anyone that knows Sister Johnson, whenever she asks you to do something, you can't say no. And me personally, I can't tell her no, because over my life, Sister Johnson has done a number of things for me. And I'll start right there. A little bit over 10 years ago, when I was trying to get employed as a special agent with a federal law enforcement agency, Sister Johnson, who knows me well, I would put her down on all of my paperwork, on all of my applications, as a reference for my background investigator to speak with, because the background investigator has to speak to someone to talk about your character and trying to find out what kind of a person you are. So I always put Sister Johnson down, and I think she was contacted numerous times by different investigators, and I appreciated that. And that's the first point that I want to make to our youth today, is character. Having good character with everyone. Not having good character, just having good character overall as a person. Because people are always watching you. And you never know who you're going to need in life. The way the background investigation works, I put Sister Johnson down. So I know the investigator is going to go and talk to her. During that process, he's going to ask her a series of questions about other people that may know me. She's going to throw out other names. Let's say she may throw out the name, well, he goes to Kashmere Church of Christ, the minister is Brother Frazier. You know what that person's going to do, that investigator? He's going to come to Kashmere one day during the week and track down Brother Frazier. I didn't put Brother Frazier down on my paperwork, but behind my back, he's going to be contacted, right? So hopefully, I've done well. I've done good to Brother Frazier, and I haven't mistreated him, and I've conducted myself in a good way in his presence as well, so that when he speaks on my behalf, it'll be good news said as well. I always treat people, young people, I always treat people right, because you never know who you may need one day. I always keep a good name. People talk. People talk both good about you and bad about you, depending on how you present yourselves. Good things spread, bad things spread. So just be aware of that and conduct yourself accordingly. Always have respect. Have respect for yourself, have respect for others as well. It goes a long way. First of all, my journey. I'll start off with college. I attended Prairie View Annual, and before I graduated, I didn't know, but someone told me, you need to try and do an internship or a co-op program to help you get a job once you graduate. I applied for a couple of internships, and I was blessed. The second one I applied for, I got it. It was with the USDA, the U.S. Department of Agriculture. I got that internship. To all of our young people who are in high school or about to go to college or in college, I highly suggest, before you graduate, search out opportunities, internships, co-op programs, summer programs in your fields of study. It does a number of good things for you. One thing it does, it gives you experience. It also gives you exposure. It gives you networking opportunities. If you get the internship while you're working for whatever company, you're able to cross paths with the recruiter, cross paths with the bosses, and you're able to meet them and impress them. So one day, after you graduate, and you're looking for a job, if they have two names on a piece of paper, one person that they don't know that's looking for a job, and your name on a piece of paper that you interned with them a couple of years earlier and made a good impression, who are they going to hire? Chances are they're going to hire you, right? So that's why that's important. Also, when you work these internships or co-op programs, give it your all. Don't be a slacker and just do the bare minimum. Go above and beyond. Have a good work ethic. Go early, stay late. Seek work, seek knowledge. You know, if you have nothing to do, go around to bosses and inquire. Sir, ma'am, anything I can help you with? People take notice of them. They may not have anything for you to do, but they take notice of your desire to want to learn, to want to work, and that goes a long way. Also, internships, most times, they tend to lead to permanent employment. I was blessed
When I did my internship, at the very end of the internship, the officer in charge came to me and he said, once you graduate and get your degree, I'll be happy to hire you on full time. You did a good job. I graduated on a Saturday. I went back to work as a full time employee the following Monday. I never had to look for a job, which is a blessing, to find a job that quick in your career field. I always have zeal, have drive, have self-motivation. Show some desire. People notice that. And in general, most people are willing to help you if they see that you're trying. But if you're just lazy, acting like you don't care, whatever, then most people are going, they're not going to extend their hand to you unless they see that you're trying, and then they'll try for you. I went back after graduation and worked for the USD as a regulatory investigator for about 3 years. While I was working with USDA, I was exposed to other federal agencies, more specifically federal law enforcement agencies. And that, it piqued my interest. Those jobs, they seemed more exciting, more appealing. And that kind of just sparked my interest. And I started doing some research to find out about the special agent positions. And I found out that I met the basic qualifications, which is a bachelor's degree. However, from just talking to different people in that field, I was told that normally the people that they hire are people with military experience, people with prior law enforcement experience, people with advanced degrees, such as master's or doctorate degrees, or people with investigative experience. I then tried to figure out, even though I meet the basic qualifications, what do I need to do to make myself more appealing? What do I need to do to make myself more marketable? One thing that I thought about, let me try and get some investigative experience, because that's a category that they love. I then applied for a position with the USDA as a regulatory investigator with the USDA. Once I got that position, I then started applying for your special agent positions, your investigators with federal law enforcement agencies. I applied with the Secret Service at one point. I went through their long process. At the end of the process, I was not hired. And that was God looking out for me, actually. I didn't know it at the time. I didn't know why I wasn't hired. I was kind of hurt by it and just didn't know why. But knowing what I know now, that was not the job for me. I've worked with those guys a lot the past few years, and the travel is horrendous. It's extensive travel. Those guys are living in hotels, living on planes, away from their families all the time. That wouldn't have been the job for me. I would have ended up quitting. But God knew that. So God told me no at the time. Even though I didn't know, God was looking out for me. Another job I put in for was with the DEA. I wanted to be an agent with the DEA. But I didn't know at that time, once you go to the academy, you've quit your job. You've committed to DEA. You've gone to the academy. Went into the academy. That's when you're told your duty station. They can tell you anywhere in the United States, anywhere, Los Angeles, New York, Atlanta, it doesn't matter. That wouldn't work well for me. I wasn't willing to go anywhere in the United States because of family here in Houston. So again, I received a no. God was looking out for me, and I didn't even know it. So, because I wanted to still get the job, I didn't know why I was being told no. So I said to myself, what do I need to do to even better my chances? Now I'm getting regulatory investigative experience, but I need to do more to improve my chances. So, one thing that I decided to do, I wasn't going to go to the military at that point in my life. I thought about getting my master's degree, and that was an option. I seriously thought about doing that. But then another option was prior law enforcement. Hello? Excuse me. Was trying to do law enforcement experience. And I started seeking out those opportunities. I reached out to the constable's office and also to the Harris County Sheriff's Office, and also to HP. What I decided to do was I applied with the Harris County
with the Harris County Sheriff's Office to try and gain that experience to make myself more marketable. I was accepted by Harris County, went to their academy. The academy was a year long. It was a night school. Worked out well. About 2 months after on patrol here in Houston, Homeland Security Investigations called me, and they offered me the special agent job that I really wanted. I accepted that job in a city that I was willing to accept, that was within driving distance of Houston for the sake of my family. I went to the academy in Georgia for about 6 months, finished the academy, and then I was stationed in Laredo, Texas, down on the southwest border, right? Mexico. Laredo, Texas is Mexico, basically, literally. I was stationed in Laredo, Texas, mostly working narcotics investigations and also human smuggling investigations. I was there for about 6 years, still trying to put in for paperwork to transfer to Houston. Eventually, I got a transfer to our office in Victoria, Texas. Came to Victoria, worked there for about 2 years, working in child exploitation and kiddie porn cases, as well as narcotics cases. Last year, finally, I was blessed to have my transfer here to Houston. Now I'm out here in Houston, I'm now assigned to a gang group, working gang investigations, working the Bloods, the Crips, MS-13, Southwest Cholos, 59 Bounty Hunters, and all the various gangs that operate in the Houston area. Now, I've been blessed. I've really been blessed, no doubt about it. I can say within the past 9 years, I haven't worked a single day. Basically, I get paid, and I think I get paid pretty good for a hobby. It's not work. I love going to work, and I think it's a good thing to say that, you know, I haven't worked in 9 years. I get paid to go somewhere every day, but it's not work though, because I enjoy it. And some of the perks of the job, and again, I'm not trying to sell my job to you, what I'm trying to do is motivate you, whatever your desire is, whatever your career field is, go after that career field, plan a path, and go after it with your all to try and achieve success, whatever it is. One thing I want to mention, in 2016, I was on detail for a number of months in the Secret Service, traveling with them, doing presidential protection of Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton. And I noticed something, and this is Black History Month. I noticed something at some of the rallies, if you want to call them that, that we've come a long way as far as Black history. We've come a long way, but there's still some major issues in society. Just being around some of these people at some of the rallies was pretty concerning. Coming in with the Confederate flags, some of the chanting that was going on, some of the sidebar conversations that you would overhear. Racism is still very much alive and well in 2018. And it appears that the movement is actually growing right now. Youth. As an African-American youth, you need to position yourself where people cannot tell you no. You need to work, not to be cliche, but you need to work twice as hard or outwork other people to ensure that you have the same opportunities in life. Don't give anyone an excuse or a reason to deny you of anything. Over-prepare. So that it's hard for an employer or for someone to tell you no. One more thing I think that's worth mentioning is how we present ourselves. We live in a society, we live in America. We have to present ourselves in a mainstream fashion. Some people are trying to be cool and, let's say, get grills. You may want to reconsider your grill if you hope to have a certain type of career. I'm not telling you what to do, but you may want to reconsider your grill.
you may want to reconsider putting tats on your face, on your neck. You're being judged by them, and the judgment is not a positive judgment by those that matter. Now, myself on the street, yeah, it's positive, but truthfully, those people shouldn't matter to you. Your hair, you know, just present yourself. Whatever style that you choose to wear, still have it presentable, basically. Your pants, sagging pants, trying to be cool, pull up your pants. Look like somebody, look decent. Dress the part. Dress professional. When you go to an interview, dress for the part. Know how to communicate with people. Speak proper English. Don't go in speaking bonnets, trying to be cool, talking slang. Speak proper English. One more thing. A lot of jobs. A lot of careers nowadays, mine included, very much so, but a lot of other careers as well, people are checking credit history. All right? As a young adult, before you start getting credit cards, can't maintain good credit history. They can come back to bite you, not only in employment, but just in life in general. Credit is important. Criminal history. Don't get a criminal history. It hurts you. Trust me. I see it every day. It hurts you a lot. Conduct yourself in a certain way that you don't get caught up with the law. Once you get caught up and get into the system, it's hard to overcome it at that point. The best way is never to get caught up from the beginning. Education. I understand that everyone goes to college. I'm not telling everyone to go to college. But what I am recommending, go to college, get a degree, or go to a trade school, get some type of license, certification, or something that's going to make you marketable in the real world. Right? You go seek employment. Or the military. Learn a trade, learn discipline, learn something in the military. The main point is preparation. Prepare for your life. Don't just think things are just going to happen automatically. Young people, that's not the way the world works. It's preparation on your part. You make things happen. And of course, God will bless you, but you still have to take action on your own to make things happen for yourself. One more thing, I think I mentioned it earlier about respect. Respect is big. Self-respect for yourself, the way you carry yourself, and also just general respect for other people. Respect for your elders, and just respect for mankind. Be mannerable. You'd be amazed at how far sir and ma'am goes in society. Yes, sir. No, sir. Yes, ma'am. No, ma'am. That's rare nowadays. But when people hear it, they take notice of it. And I guarantee you, the average person that hears you say yes, sir, and no, sir, yes, ma'am, and no, ma'am, is going to take a liking to you. I'm serious about that. I always go above and beyond. Don't stay by just trying to do the bare minimum. Okay? Go above and beyond. Give it your all in whatever that you do. Networking and relationships. It's not always about what you know. What you know is important, but sometimes it is about who you know. And that goes to just having good, positive relationships with people that can help you. Now, sometimes in life, you may not know exactly who's in a position to help you. That's where it pays to treat everybody right. Have good relationships with everyone. So when that time comes, that person is willing to help you because they like you. And that's all it is. That's all that I have for you. I think my time is up. But young people, I hope that you took a couple of points away. Sister Johnson wanted to give a couple of minutes for anyone that may have any questions. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. First of all, I want to say We thank God for his mercy and his grace. And we thank Kashmere Gardens for hosting this program that helps us to understand who am I. We want to thank all our law and all types of our law enforcement men and women who are of the armed forces that serve and protect our country, that keeps us safe from foreign and domestic attacks. My question, as the program was going on, we witnessed history being made by having our first Afro-American president and First Lady Michelle Obama by his side. You know, the scripture came to my mind of he who finds a wife finds a good thing.
That's right.
So my question is, in terms of sacrifices that we have made, the great strides that we have made towards equality, do you find that we still have a great way to go? We thank you too for giving us the young people and all of us keys of success that we can use in our everyday life to be all that God would have us to be. But do you find that there are even greater strides that need to be made and that the torch needs to be passed on to our young people?
Definitely. One thing that I just thought about is at work, in my job. Last year, I was detailed for 5 months to our academy in Georgia. I was there teaching. And several classes came through while I was there teaching. Our class size is normally about 24 cadets. The average number of blacks per class were two. Two out of 24. We don't have very many blacks in our agency. And actually, all of your federal law enforcement agencies, I work with them on a daily basis, FBI, DEA, ATF, Secret Service, the U.S. Marshals, Homeland Security, it's not very many blacks. When I was at the academy, it was an average of about two per class. Some classes would have one, and then you'd have a class that may have three, so the average was two. So that just goes to say that the ratio, in my opinion, is not what it should be. I'm not sure if we just don't know about the career field, or if we know about the career field, but we've put ourselves in a position whereby we're not qualified for the position due to criminal history or prayer, whatever the case might be. I'm not really sure, but I know there's an issue. Also, since I've been working games, it's sad. Here in Houston, on the streets of Houston, our youth, our teenagers, just the lack of respect, the lack of value for life, just talking to them. Earlier this week, we were dealing with a gang member, 14-year-old kid, 14 years old. And I was talking to him a little bit. He was very nonchalant. I was talking to him, no. Looking away, not even looking at me. And I asked him, do you have both parents at home? And he said, yes, he does. I said, okay, do you listen to him? His answer, he looked at me and said, when I want to.
Oh my God.
14 years old, listens to his parents when he wants to. So anyway, we do have a ways to go, and we have to do better for ourselves as a community. I don't think we can depend on others to help us. We need to make some internal changes and do better for ourselves.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Give another round of applause. Another round of applause. Now, at this time, coming all the way from Jensen, from the North Houston Church of Christ, I want y'all to give them a Kashmere welcome. Welcome them to the stage.
Welcome. Say greetings from the Northwest Church of Christ. These roots don't go just to Kelsey, they go all the way to Nacogdoches, Louisiana. That's my dad's roots down there. He made us sing, he whooped us to sing. We got some brothers and sisters that love to sing. I got some brothers that love to sing. But this man here almost like Michael Jackson, man. He whooped us to sing.
I'm all the way from Nacogdoches, Louisiana. 79 years old. Worship at the North Houston Church of Christ. For the principal of my 55 years, who am I?
You are unseen.
Yeah.
Yeah.
now, at this time, before we allow her to give her special appreciation, we want to give a special appreciation to our director, writer, producer, just all of that. She put this whole thing together. We want to give a token of our appreciation to Sister Pamela Johnson. So we want to present her with these flowers here. Amen. Amen. Wow. Now we'll allow her to give her special appreciation.
I was just telling Lynette, you all sure know how to make a person want to cry. And I'm one of those that doesn't take very much, and my family can tell you that. But I thank you all so very much, but it's really not about me, and I want to stress that. It's all about the Lord. Amen. And when I think in terms of what God has gifted us with, we have talents, gifts, abilities, that oftentimes goes unnoticed. I just want to take a bit of time to say some special appreciations to people who worked with me in presenting and coordinating this program. Again, thank you.
Yes.
Yesterday, by pure accident, this young man over here, Logan, stepped into the position of being the MC, and he wowed us with his radio voice. And thank you. I want you to realize that in Romans 13 and 7, it says to give honor to whom honor is due. And that's what I want to do right now. When you got your program, you should have gotten with it some poetry. Please take a look at that poetry. You see, I used to be an English teacher, and I love poetry. So when you look at those poems, they were created by our own sisters here at Kashmere. Sister Margaret Fields, if she could just raise her hand, that big. Love that sister. Sister Margie Watts, love that sister. Their creativity and talent with their rhyme and rhythm and beat and the spoken word given to us, please take copies home with you. Also, I want to thank you, the audience. All of this that you see, it wouldn't matter as much if you were not. So, truly, we appreciate you, our audience. When I think in terms of all that has happened today, we had a beautiful sermon this morning. Tips back to some history. The 30s, that was our sermon. And then it kind of brought it all together. to where we are today, knowing that God's word surpasses from where I think up until now, it remains the same. And I know we appreciate that. I know the Burton family is leaving out, because I know they have to get back on Jensen Jack Drive side of town. But weren't they beautiful? Noah made that connection for us. And they confirmed with her, and they did a magnificent job. Not them alone. Inspired, I think you all are still here.
Amen.
Thank you, Inspired. We say you are much appreciated. I'm not taking that from Tupac. That's Pam Johnson. You are much appreciated. Thank you all so very much for that. You know, when I think in terms of other people who I want to talk about today, I want to talk about Marcus. Marcus is still here. Marcus, no. Marcus.
Amen.
Marcus, oh man. Love Marcus. You have a way. Like my husband said earlier, before service started today, we would love to have you every time we do a Black History program. You make a difference. You truly make a difference. Thank you. When I think in terms of our food today. You know, I knew Kashmere sisters knew how to do it up right. I already knew that. But when I walked over there and I saw food smelling real good, and I walked in as if it were walking into a Black History Museum. I wasn't expecting that. Oh, I walked in and I saw all kind of little archival type things and brochures and things on the wall. If you all didn't check it out. It's a lot of history over there that those sisters got together. They have them on the tables. They have them on the walls. It was like a Black History Museum of documents. Thank you, sisters. All of you that had a part in that. Thank you so very much. At this time, most of you know I used to be a speech and drama teacher. And when I retired about 2 years ago, I said I wanted the Lord to use me. And I asked God to use me. And one of the things I wanted to do was to take what I believe God gave me, and I wanted to use it among my brothers and sisters. I'm going to ask at this time all of those who participated in the Who Am I presentation, would you just please come up? Been the same without having our guest speaker, Anthony Pierce. Anthony, I'm going to ask you to join us. Everything I asked Anthony to do, he went above and beyond. Thank you so very much. We appreciate it. Please give him another round of applause. When we talk about putting together a program of this sort, it would be nothing without the people that work behind the scenes. So let me just briefly tell you a little bit about that. Look behind me. They look nice. Persons responsible, I have to decorate the table, the chairs rather, but persons responsible for the backdrop. James LaCour, the second and the third. We call him Little James. He's not little anymore, but we call him Little James. James is unique. I I want to see. He makes it happen. I'm just talking and talking and talking. And he makes it come to life. You know, and I'm like, wow. He just took it from here and he's just doing things with his hands. And I know that's a gift. Thank you. You know, these presenters that you see up here, you see them in their regalia, their makeup. I didn't do that. It takes a team. There are a few people I want to recognize, and I know one of them is saying, she goes, don't do that, don't do that. I can see she's doing that from her seat. But I'm going to ask, if you would please, just to stand where you are. I'm going to miss somebody, so help me if I miss anybody. Lynette, please stand. Woo! Sister Regina, please stand. You guys are passing the baton on all the way down to one of our high school students. Cheyenne intends to be a cosmetologist, so she well knows how to do makeup. And she did a really good job with getting the makeup and wardrobing together, and as well as the others had. And I don't think I missed anybody on that one, but technology, programming, Jeremy Johns. Our life system, Sister Linda Jackson. And if you didn't know, it is being filmed so that this will appear on television sets. Okay, so we want you to know that. As I'm looking at my little notes, I'm trying not to miss anybody. Parents, oh, thank you guys so much for supporting and helping us to get this together. And you guys, you just got to see my little mentee. Where is she?
Alicia.
It's not the one I'm looking for, because I'm talking about her mentee. Aaliyah. You know, this young lady is special in many ways. That monologue that she performed, I had written that, and I was going to be too heavy for her. Not at all. She's a natural, and I tell her all the time that we're going to see her name in lights. So remember that name. And this young lady right here, Miss Alicia, this is the one that prayerfully I'll be casting the baton down anytime soon. Lord, say the same. But she is my mentee. And she's one of those, as I was preparing, she just reads me. She's reading my expression. Just, Sister Pam, what's wrong? What's wrong? You know, and she's trying to fix it for me. And I tell her, she helps me keeping the heavy off of me. Thank you so much. And as I close, I cannot close without saying something about our minister, Brother Frazier. Brother Frazier, you are a gift to Kashmere. This brother, our minister, is so supportive. He puts his hands in everything. He's the one that caused me to even want to start doing and coordinating a Black History program. It's all because of you that I'm doing it. Okay, so we thank him for that. And the kids are blowing something in my ear because I left one person out. And I left him for last. And that's Brother Reed Johnson. making sure we get it. And so again, to my husband, B. Johnson. So, to all of you, we say thank you and we appreciate you.
Keep it going. Round of applause. Keep it going. Now, for a few closing remarks, we'll have the minister here at the Kashmere Gardens Church of Christ. My brother, Winsford, Frazier. Hey man, everybody, just give me just one more round of applause. I tell you, this program has been fantastic. I was smiling all the way through. Haley and Jazaria singing. I'll tell you, it's really been beautiful. And the best is yet to come. We definitely want to thank Sister Pam for job building and hard work and some stress, but it all paid off. Now, I want to just say briefly, on a serious note, I was really in it early this morning, and I do feel like I need to give some more time on the sermon, but I'm not going to do it. I said, really? I do want to share this with you. Black history is really worth us remembering. And there's a passage of scripture in Isaiah 46 and verse 9. The New King James Version says, I remember the former days of old, for I am God, and there is no one else. And God says, remember the former things of old. Now, contextually, Israel had history, and God calls upon them to remember their history. And in looking at Israel, there's four things, real quickly. I promise you, I'm looking at the clock. Four things, real quickly, why we should remember history. Number one, history identifies where and how things came to be. At some point in your life, you're gonna ask the question, how did this happen? Using the ironing board. How many of us don't use the ironing board? Even if you take your clothes to the cleaners, if you go to the cleaners I go to, you're going to see an ironing board even in the cleaners. Are you with me? But where did that ironing board come from? So many things that we use, we take for granted. History teaches us where and how things came to be. This is worth remembering because at some point you're going to ask, how did this happen? Where did this come from? But then history also identifies what to repeat. And there are some things in history that you don't want to repeat. Like what Brother Anthony was talking about regarding the young man and how disrespectful he was. That happened some time ago. Don't want to repeat that. There are some things that have happened in the past that we don't want to repeat. There's a lot of crime. There's a lot of protesting going on across. That was protesting years ago. We remember history because we don't want detrimental things to happen today that happened years gone by. But then there are some good things that we want to repeat. We can't be the first African-American general, a 4- or 5-star general. That's gone. But what it took to get to that point, we can repeat that. That can be repeated over and over and over again.
all the qualities that Brother Anthony talked about, being courteous, polite. We were taught that when we were coming up. That's not expired. That's not old folk. We can repeat that. We can repeat it over and the same values and the same advantages that it got us can get our next generation. And then history tells us how far other folk have come and it energizes us to go further. Are y'all with me? I don't know if you've ever been riding with someone, you got a 16-hour drive and you drive 8 hours and then you've got another drive and the driver says, where are we? We're halfway. Can you pick up? Okay, I know where we are. Now, let's go forward. So, history lets us know how far we've come and how far it helps us to visualize how far we need to go. And then, see, I'm doing good. I got one more. This is the big one for me. History gives us something to celebrate. History gives us something to celebrate. If you look at the Old Testament, and if you take the time to read Deuteronomy 16, that's the festival. That's the festival chapter. Festival, feast of the Passover, feast of booths, feast of all those festivals, and every festival was rooted in history. The Lord wanted them to celebrate, remember when I brought you out of Egyptian bondage. Remember when you sat in booths or tents for 40 years and I gave you shoes that didn't wear out. I rained manna from heaven, blue quail in from the clothes that didn't wear out. Then I brought you to this land that's flowing with milk and honey. Remember where you came from. And look at our table that we look at every Sunday. This dude in remembrance of me. What keeps me going? What keeps my spirit renewed? Every day I remember the cross. I don't wait until Sunday to remember the cross. Every day that I wake up, I remember Jesus died for me. And by the grace of God, I am what I am. And that's why we have something to celebrate. Because somebody did something. Somebody brought us. Somebody is providing for us. Somebody is paving, have paved a way for us. And so when it comes down to days like this, I know that this is the Lord's day. I know that this day we give glory and honor to God. And we've done that today. We've done that today. When I look at these young people and how they have worked together, how they've been obedient, how they have cooperated, all of the Christian qualities that went into producing a program of this caliber, I say our glory and honor goes to God. The fact that they've committed to memory some good, some wholesome. I know that there are some things out there that are constantly bombarding their minds, but they set that aside and they apply this to their mind. All glory and honor belongs to God. And I just have I have many requests, but at this point I'm going to ask this of you. Sometimes, church, we are such a hard audience. We are a hard audience. Man, we will look at folk and they're giving their best and if somebody is giving God honor, if God is being glorified in these children, you ought to let it be known that we agree 100%. Don't sit there and let them do all of this and not give them your agreement. Amen. Let's stop being that way. I'm not saying that you ought to jump over benches and do a lot of things that are not in good taste. I'm not saying that. But just don't sit there and be nonchalant as if it's nothing. Because this is something. It's something. It's something.